1912 New York, Dr. Alexis Carrel of the Rockefeller Institute claimed that he had discovered the secret to immortality. He had in his lab cells he took from a chicken's heart that kept growing indefinitely. No cell culture had ever been grown for this long. Something like 20 plus years, well past the lifespan of a chicken. People thought that he had done it. Death and aging would soon be a thing of the past, they thought. The solution he was adding to this specimen had to be the elixir of life. Hi, my name is Pranav and you're watching Science is Dope. And in this video, we're gonna talk about immortality. Let's begin. Henrietta Lacks, a 31-year-old mother of five, walks into the hospital's gynecology ward complaining of knots in her womb. The barely educated patient describes knot in her own words, and the doctor gives her an examination. He had seen 1,000 tumors at this point, but he still finds this one unusual. He finds a lump that is solid, hard, and purple, which he described as being like grape jello, bleeding at the slightest touch. He extracts a sample of the tumor and sends it to the lab, and Henrietta is sent into radiation treatment. Neither of them had any idea of the significance of this moment. Dr. George Guy was a researcher who grew human cell samples in a lab. Growing cells outside the body, aka cell culture, is an important tool in biomedical research. This technique is what allows us to study the cells in our bodies during normal function, during disease conditions, and for testing out drugs. Now, he had been trying to maintain continuously dividing cells in his lab for years. He tried many techniques on different cells in specially controlled environments over years of research. Many of them would grow for a day or two and then die. He wanted cells that could live forever. But wait a minute, wasn't this already achieved by Dr. Alexis Carrel with his immortal chicken heart that was all over the media and newspapers a couple of decades before? Well, to begin with, Alexis Carrel was a eugenicist. He had many controversial opinions on race and gender, which he regularly published in articles and books. Even though his work had the potential to benefit all of humanity, he was only interested in furthering the survival of people he deemed good. He wanted to give certain people a chance to be immortal, while for others, he recommended letting them slowly die out, or worse, forced sterilization. Carrel died in 1944, awaiting trial for collaborating with the Nazis. 2 years after Carrel's death, his assistant threw out what was remaining of his immortal chicken heart. Something very important for the validity of any scientific work is replicability. Any scientific discovery or achievement has to be replicable. If someone else were to try the same protocol or the same type of samples, they should be able to achieve the same results. This, it turns out, is not a feature of Alexis Carrel's work. Nobody else was able to replicate immortal chicken heart cells, even though many tried. Carrel was a big name in science back then, being a Nobel Prize winner and all, and there wasn't much criticism for his work. All that there was about how difficult his methods were and how his work was very hard to replicate. Scientist Leonard Hayflick was intrigued by Carrel's work, but he couldn't replicate it either. He grew suspicious, and after many experiments with cell cultures, he came to the conclusion that most normal cells could only divide a set number of times before dying off. In 1962, he demonstrated that this number of divisions is specific for normal cells for a particular species. This limit in division is now called the Hayflick limit. So what was happening with those immortal cells? Hayflick believed that knowingly or unknowingly, the solution that Carrel used to feed his culture was also providing fresh stem cells every time. So the dying cells were replaced by new cells. But another explanation is that at some point, the cells were contaminated by the rahul sarcoma virus, a virus which can transform the cells to become cancerous, meaning that the immortality of the cells was due to cancer. We're all familiar with cancer, a disease which arises from tumors and their uncontrollable growth. But how did these tumors form? To explain it simply, the cells in our body have an inbuilt mechanism that tells them when to stop dividing. But when cells become cancerous, usually from a mutation, they lose this ability and start multiplying uncontrollably. Not only that, cancer cells are sometimes extremely good at survival, sometimes even better than our healthy cells. They're capable of surviving on less resources, and they also have the ability to direct our body's resources towards them. You might ask, hey, isn't that a good feature all cells should have? The problem is that when cells become cancerous, they stop working for the organism's survival. Every cell, tissue, or organ in the body performs some function for the organism to survive. Cancer cells, however, work only for themselves and use the body's resources. In fact, the body's own immune system recognizes cancer as a threat and tries to remove it. It's when it fails that the individual dies without external help. When Dr. Guy got a sample of Henrietta cells, he didn't even realize its significance. He saw them as any other cells, nothing remarkable. But day by day, Henrietta cells would divide exponentially. He would move part of them to separate vials and they would just keep growing. He did this for months and there seemed to be no end in sight. He had finally done it. He finally had the world's first human immortal cells. He called them HeLa cells, named after the woman they came from. As soon as Guy announced his discovery to his colleagues in the scientific world, interest sparked. Everyone wanted some HeLa for their own research, and Guy was generous. He offered. Soon the discoveries and developments followed. The first polio vaccine was developed thanks to HeLa cells, which led to their mass production. The cells were soon shipped everywhere via various modes of transport, which also led to the development of better ways of transporting biological samples. One early experiment using HeLa cells even sent them to outer space to see the effects of space travel on human cells. Study after study, HeLa cells were transforming the world of biomedical science. They were being produced by the tons in different parts of the world. These cells even helped uncover one of the leading causes of cervical cancer, the disease that killed Henrietta Lacks, from which the HPV vaccine was developed. The first human genetic sequencing was done on HeLa cells. Even the COVID-19 vaccine was developed using research done on HeLa cells. Today, long after Henrietta's death, HeLa cells are still alive. In fact, all the people alive today, including you, have benefited in some way, shape, or form by some research that was done on the cells, be it a vaccine or a medicine that was developed using HeLa cells. The question now is, what about the future? Can we achieve immortality using them? I'll get to that, but first, the story of HeLa cells is incomplete. There is a side of this story that gets a little dark. Henrietta Lacks was black, and this was a time in the US when legal racial segregation was practiced. And Johns Hopkins was the only hospital she could find that would even treat black patients. She or her family were not asked for permission when a piece of her tumor was taken and used for scientific research. All of the progress that it helped make, or even the fact that her cells were still around, were not known by her family for decades. Henrietta passed away 8 months after being diagnosed with cancer. While millions were made from the sale and research involving HeLa cells, her family was stuck in poverty, not even able to afford the basic healthcare they needed. It took a long time for Henrietta's family to learn about HeLa cells still being around, let alone the impact they had. Not only was this unjust and exploitative, the mass availability of the genetic information in HeLa cells was a violation of their privacy. Since then, there have been several media reports on the Lacks story that have given the family an avenue to discuss their grievances and get some form of justice, and some say in the matter of utilization of these cells. When I first came across the story, I had so many questions. What makes cancers immortal? If this is the case with HeLa cells, shouldn't there be other cancer cells that are immortal? And if cells can be immortal, can it be applied to entire organisms? Let's answer them all. First, why are cancer cells immortal? Here's what happens when cells divide. At the end of chromosomes in your DNA, there are sections called telomeres. When cells divide into two, the telomeres are not copied fully and basically they shrink a little. So every time a cell divides, the telomeres keep shrinking, and at some point, they disappear. Now the cell can't divide anymore and it dies a natural death. This is a Hayflick limit that I already spoke about. What cancer cells do is they overcome this Hayflick limit because they produce an enzyme called telomerase, which normal cells don't. And what telomerase does is it restores the telomeres lost during cell division, allowing cancer cells to divide indefinitely. In fact, one of the proposed treatments of cancer is by inhibiting this telomerase enzyme, which will result in cancer cells dying a natural death. Now, are there other immortal cells other than HeLa? Yes, there's a bunch of them, and most of them are cancerous. Here they are on your screen. Finally, if human cells can be mortal, can humans be mortal? That's a big question involving answering several other questions. Do you just want to live longer or do you want to live healthier longer? Do you want to be completely resilient to diseases and damage? Can we regrow entire human organs like Carrel once imagined? Although this all sounds very complicated, there have been exciting developments in these areas in the last few decades. One promising research is by Dr. David Sinclair, who has already achieved anti-aging in mice. We understand the mechanism of immortal cells. We understand the mechanism of aging. Now, it's not a question of if we unlock the secrets to immortality, but when. Who knows, maybe we'll see some form of immortality in our lifetimes. The exploitative nature behind HeLa cells kickstarted a conversation on informed consent. Today, any tissue removed from a patient to be used in research needs to have consent from the patient or their close family members by law. And today, even though the family has not received any compensation for the companies that have profited off of HeLa cells, Henrietta's family have a say in how the cells are going to be used moving forward. A special committee has been formed with 2 lakhs family members to review applications from scientists who wish to use HeLa cells in their research. Henrietta's cancer might have taken her life, but it definitely saved yours. Content like this is expensive for me to make. If you did like this video, I'd really appreciate it if you support me on Patreon, Buy Me Coffee, YouTube memberships, the thanks button, or by buying my merch or visiting my website. Links are down below. If you like this video, you might also like this one that I did on a pharma company that made faulty medicines, putting people's lives at risk while still making profit. I'll see you in the next one. Till then, remember, science is dope.